Good morning. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen.
It is with joy that I welcome each and every one of you to this time of worship with Covenant Presbyterian Church. We are in multiple different locations, both on our campus as well as around the city and all over the world. Today, we have people here with us in the sanctuary. Squeezed every chair we can in here and have filled every chair. We have quite a number of you worshiping in FE 200 in overflow space. I hope that you will join in, know that you are a part of this worshiping community. Stand, sing when we sing, pray as we pray, and know that God is with us. We have people joining us via our live stream all over. This is an exciting day that we are united together as one worshiping community, and I'm grateful that we can all be together today. If you're with us on campus and you got an order of service when you came in, we hope you'll take those home with you at the end of today. Because Easter's so early in the calendar this year, we have quite a number of things that are coming up in the life of this community. There's an Explore membership class if you're newer to this church and would like to learn more or ask questions and get to know some people. It's two Wednesday nights in April. You can find information there and sign up. You can see that there's information about events where we are getting ready for the presidential election. I don't know if you've heard, there's going to be one in the fall. And we're having another courageous conversation to try to engage in that in healthy ways as a community. There's formation cohorts. There are all kinds of ways that you are being invited to come and to be a part of what God is doing here. And we hope that you'll take these bulletins home with you and to consider how you can join us in what's taking place. Again, friends, it is my joy that we can be together on this Easter morning. So I invite all who are able, wherever you are, to stand and join in our call to worship. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
He has given us new life and hope. He has raised Jesus from the dead.
God has claimed us as his own.
He has brought us out of darkness. He has made us light to the world.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
seated. What a joyful, glorious morning. It is good that we celebrate what Christ has done for us. It is good that we recognize the resurrection and the hope that comes from it. But it's also really important to recognize our own need for a Lord and Savior this morning. So let us take time to confess our sins, first silently, and then using the prayer that is printed in your bulletin. Please pray with me. Saying together, all-powerful God, we confess that even on this most holy day, we are unable to believe in the victory over death shown to us in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We confess our utter dependence on you, not only for life, but also for faith, hope, and love. Without your astonishing appearance to our ancestors and your stunning presence throughout the ages, we would be lost. Forgive us and transform us, that in every way our work and prayer will make whole what is broken and give peace on earth. Amen. It is true that Christ the Lord is risen today. Hear the good news this morning. Because of his sacrifice, because of his deep love, because of his victory over death, our sins, yours and mine, are forgiven. Hallelujah and amen. Let's stand. This morning, I pray, I hope, I trust that you are full of joy, that you are full in recognizing the freedom that comes from Christ. And this morning, you are filled with peace. Let us take time to share those things with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Before we read our Easter text for today from Matthew 28, I just want you to engage it with a question in your mind, one single question. And it may be the most important question you will ever ask in your entire life. And it's this as we read it. Do you believe this? Like, do you really believe it? And I know we're in church. I know what the answer is supposed to be. But if we promise we're not going to give you truth serum and then put you on a microphone and make you say something, I'd like you to listen and ask yourself the question, what do you believe? Because something happened here that has changed our world forever. So what do you believe? After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came down and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. For I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, and this is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples, and suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers and sisters to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, I pray no matter who we are or how we gather here, what hopes, what beliefs, what doubts, what dreams, what questions we bring today, that you would meet every one of us where we are and we would experience your gospel, your good news, which would change us forever. We pray all this in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. So what do you believe? What do you believe about this? Do you believe that this is a historical reality? Do you believe that there was a carpenter in Galilee and from Galilee in a kind of podunk part of the Roman Empire who 2,000 years ago was killed on a cross, was buried in a tomb, and 3 days later rose again as Savior and Messiah of the world? Or are you in the kind of a camp that's going, I don't know why we need to go there today? Easter's great. Can dress in pastels and go to church and go to lunch, take a nap this afternoon. Got great family traditions, might get some good pictures. I'm okay with that. What do you believe about today? The gospel writers, including Matthew, they assume that when you heard this story, you were not going to believe. They assume that when you heard this, that like most people in history, you would think, hey, when someone dies, they stay dead. There's a kind of snobbery that we need to be careful of as people in our day and age, that we might look back on kind of ancient people and go, well, they may have believed in this stuff and kind of fairy tales. And, you know, this is a story of good over evil. It's like, you know, it's like Star Wars. I love these kind of movies. I love these stories. This is great stuff, right? But dead people don't come back to life. We're modern people. We're scientific people. We have understanding of this stuff that they didn't have at the time. We need to be careful with that attitude. Because one of the things about modern life that we have done is that we have pushed death away in as many ways as possible. In fact, some of you might be going, I don't know why you keep talking about death today. That was 3 days ago. That was Friday. We're on the happy stuff. It's on Easter. Let's keep moving in that direction. We don't like talking about it. We don't like thinking about it. For the ancients, death was something that was far less avoidable, was more a part of daily existence. And the people who were more familiar with it than likely most of us understood that when you died, you stayed dead, especially when it was at the hands of professional killers like the Romans. People don't come off the cross and 3 days later walk out of a tomb. Matthew's not anticipating that you're going to hear this and go, oh, yeah, dead person coming back to life? Yeah, I'm in on that. That sounds really good. I'm there. And so he writes it in a way that invites you to ask questions about it. I invite you to do so. For instance, one of the things that's really unique about the Gospel of Matthew is he writes in detail about these events so that we can go and fact check it. This gospel was written at a time when there would be people who were still alive that are being described in this story. And if not them, it would have been their children who would still have been alive. You can go and see this. He writes this in a way where he says, it wasn't just this guy named Jesus. He says he was from Galilee. He's from this little town on the Sea of Galilee. There's only like a few hundred people there. You can go and find out about his mom and dad. If you don't believe, go check out and see if he's real. The people there are going, yeah, we've never heard of him before. It's probably not true. I'm writing this to tell you where he's from so that you can go see. I'm writing this to tell you that he died on a cross in Jerusalem over the Passover. I'm not saying he died in a city. I'm telling you the location, that you can know where it took place and check with the people there. And I'm not just telling you there was a time in a galaxy far, far away, a long time ago where this happened. I am telling you that it happened while Caiaphas was the high priest and while Pontius Pilate was governor at the same time. That narrows it down to a very certain city in a span that can only mean a few years' time. And Matthew's going, I want you to go talk to people who were there. I'm giving you the location and the timeline of when it happened. And then he writes with specificity about the people. For instance, he says it was these two Marys who were there at the tomb on that first morning. He says in the chapter before what we just read in chapter 27, that when Jesus died on the cross, his body was brought down and he was buried in a tomb. But Matthew doesn't just say it was just a guy that came along and said, you can use my tomb. He says it was a man named Joseph. And if that's too common of a name for you, he's from a village called Arimathea. Arimathea, we know, was a small village just outside of Jerusalem on a hill, kind of looking down on the city, almost like a suburb. It would have had just probably a couple of thousand people maybe at the time. And Joseph, he says, was one of the wealthiest people in the village. And not only was he one of the wealthiest, but he was on the Jewish ruling council, the Sanhedrin. I'm telling you the time, I'm telling you the village, I'm telling you the title that he had. I am asking you to go talk to people. Because if you go to Arimathea and no one's heard of Joseph on the Sanhedrin, you know I'm making this up. If Joseph's there and say, hey, can we look in the family tomb to see if Jesus of Nazareth's body's really there? And he's there, you know we're making it up. Well, he's not saying Jesus said this thing that someone heard one day. He's like, he's alive. If you say to Joseph, hey, did you have a guy buried in the tomb that 3 days later came back to life, and Joseph's going, I don't know what you're talking about. It's probably a lie. Matthew wants us to think about this. He wants us to see that these are real people happening in real time. What do you believe that accounts for this? Or take, for example, what Matthew also records that's so interesting about the change that takes place in the disciples. I've shared this with some of you that a few years ago, someone was talking to me, and I love a conversation like this, who was not a Christian was going, I don't really believe in this. I don't know why we have to believe in this. I mean, it's like, you know, Jesus was a good teacher, but, you know, coming back from the dead, come on, man. Like, you don't actually think that's real. And I said, well, you know, I get that. It's hard to believe, but he said, you know, Jesus wasn't even unique. There were other people at the time talking about being the Messiah. And I said, you're right. There were other people. Jesus was not the only one claiming to be the Savior. I told him, help me out and explain one thing to me. Name one of them. So I don't know the names. I was like, that's right, because they died and no one talked about them again. Because they died, and when they died, they stayed dead. And if the Romans killed them, their followers do what Jesus' followers do here. They scatter, they run, they're scared, they protect themselves. But something happens in the resurrection and the immediate days afterwards where these disciples who run and hide, it's not Peter, James, and John who go to the tomb on the first morning. They're hiding. There's something about what takes place that they experience something. They see something that has never happened before in human history. And if you don't think this is true, then you've got to give me another explanation for it. Is that these remaining 11 disciples then over the next decades spread out around the Roman Empire. Not saying we have a better religion than you. Not saying we're smarter than you. Not saying that we have understanding. That not saying, hey, if you send us money, we can like answer a prayer that will like bring blessings on you as you go forward. Plant a seed and this will happen. What he say is that we've seen a dead man come back to life. and he is alive, and he is the Messiah, and he is the Savior of the world. And over those decades, almost all of them gained nothing of worldly privilege by making this claim. They were ostracized, they lived in poverty, they were hunted, they were beaten, they were mocked, and almost all of them we know were killed for this claim. Now, when in human history has that ever happened before? Not in one groupthink mass suicide. I'm talking about over decades as they were alone. Not one of them recanted and took it back. Something happened that first Easter that has never been seen in any other time, any other continent, any other culture in the world. And it has changed people for thousands of years. And I don't know about you, but when I look at these events, I believe that they are true, that it's not just a story of good over evil or right over wrong. It's a story that is real and historical. And when we come to that place of believing, it changes everything about our lives, everything about our world. It's worth giving your life to and building a life upon. It's a love story that is so powerful, it can change the very essence of society. What do you believe today? And if this is true, the ramifications of the power of the resurrection for changing our lives, it's beyond description. But to start with, and I just want you to think about this morning. I want you to think about this in your own life. It seems to me that according to the Gospel of Matthew, the first thing that the resurrection means about life is this. The first fruit, the first ripple effects of Easter are this. We don't need to be afraid anymore. Think about this for a second. We don't need to be afraid of whatever this world can throw at us and whatever the world to come will be. We don't need to be afraid anymore. Two times in these 10 verses that we read, that's the command. It's not a suggestion, it's a command given to the women. The first time, if you read, is in verse 5, and it's where, in kind of this ultimate mic drop moment, the angel just comes and rolls the tomb away, the stone away from the tomb, and just sits on it, just looking. And it says the guards are frozen in fear, which I feel like is understandable, right? But then the women come, and the first thing the angel says to the women is, do not be afraid. Now, you might look at that and go, that's natural. Right? I would understand why they're afraid. But then it's repeated. Matthew repeats it a second time. And it's in verse 10 when the women then are going back to the disciples and they see the resurrected Jesus. And the first thing Jesus says is exactly the same phrase as the angel commands, is do not be afraid. Now, what's interesting is the women don't seem afraid at this point. When you're afraid of something, you freeze or you move away from it. You want to get away from it. But here the women, it says, move towards Jesus. They're worshiping him. They're touching him as they go. And so maybe what Matthew's trying to get at is it's not just Jesus' words to the women there, but maybe these are the first fruits, the ramifications of Easter. We don't need to be afraid anymore. And so I want you to ask yourself today, what are you afraid of? What causes you worry or concern or fear? What keeps you up at night? What runs around in your head where you're making scenarios up of what you're going to do in any given moment? You might not like the word fear, but it's a base human emotion. I one time had someone talking about another person. They said, man, that guy's not scared of anything. I didn't know who they were talking about, but it's like, no, they are. Fear isn't something that's doled out to some people and not others. Fear is something every one of us has at our core. It drives human behavior. Media companies know this. Elections know this. If we can make you scared of something, we can hold your attention. Why doesn't the news have more feel-good stories? You know why? Because you and I don't click on those stories. You know the headlines that cause us to click on them? The ones that scare us, that tell us that everything is becoming unraveled, that tells us that the future is something that ought to cause us great anxiety and worry. What are you nervous about today? What are you worried about? maybe for yourself, maybe for your children, maybe for your grandchildren. We all got it. And what if the first ramifications of the angel is don't be afraid? Think about what it would mean. Again, we're holding an election in November. It's going to be fun. As engaged people, it is right and good for us to have convictions about what we are going to do in November. But what if we were unique in approaching the election, and not just November, but December and January afterwards, starting with the idea that we're not going to be scared of it? Starting with the idea that while we might spread conviction, we're not going to spread fear. Because the first fruits and ramification of Easter is we're not supposed to be afraid. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean nothing bad's going to happen? No, it doesn't mean that. Loneliness, pain, difficulty, that's a part of life. Jesus was just tortured to death on a cross. He's not looking at him going, you don't need to be afraid because every day is just going to be lollipops and rainbows in life. Jesus knew there was betrayal. Jesus knew there was loneliness. Jesus knew there was mourning. Jesus knew there was death. We are not going to be spared that, no matter what you believe. But that's not why we're supposed to lose fear. The reason we're not supposed to be afraid is because death, pain, loneliness, illness, betrayal, these things have been overturned in Easter. That these things are real, but in the resurrection we see that none of them will be the end of our stories, because we will journey with the one who has faced everything this world can throw at us, including death, and has come through it. He has walked through the valley of the shadow of death. But we don't need to fear when we walk through it, because the one who's conquered it is with us. Amen?
Amen.
That we are not supposed to be afraid of this world or other people anymore. What are you frightened of? And how liberating would it be if the words of Easter rang through the centuries to us, we aren't going to be frightened anymore. I want to close with a story that I have had running around in my head for actually a few years now, since I first heard it from a friend of mine who's a pastor. But I've been reminded of it this week because one of the things that happened yesterday at our church, some of you were probably there, was we had an Easter egg hunt for our children, run by our children and family ministries. Our church has been in this amazing, exciting season of growth, and one of the catalysts of that has certainly been our children and family ministry. It is probably as healthy and vibrant as at any point in the history of this church, if not more so. It's amazing what's taking place there and in other places. But as they held the Easter egg hunt yesterday, they had hundreds of kids and families who were there, so they had been preparing for a while, and what that meant is these plastic eggs have been literally everywhere in our office for weeks because we got 3,000 eggs. Do you know how much space 3,000 plastic eggs? I have been seeing these things everywhere for the last, I've been tripping over them, I've stepped on some, they're everywhere, right? And it's amazing what our children and our staff volunteers did. They had 3,000 of these eggs that open up, and they would put, every one of them got like a candy or a Bible verse or something that goes inside. They put it back together, and then they hit them everywhere, and then yesterday 3,000 eggs were found by hundreds of kids, and it's amazing, it's great. But I've been thinking about the story because of the plethora of plastic eggs in our office, and it's a story about a rural church. So in a little rural village, and this church was a church that had a different kind of children's ministry, in that they had one teacher who for years had taught Sunday school for their elementary children, and they would have all the kids in one room who were there from kindergarten through fifth grade. All the elementary, had a wide range that were there. And because it was a small church, they had one teacher for it, and they had this one school year, they had 9 children who were part of it. And one of the oldest children who was there was a boy whose name was Philip. And Philip was a popular, vivacious, in the middle of everything. Folks loved him. He had moved there with his family a few years before. Philip had Down syndrome, and Philip was someone who brought a unique presence and wisdom and life to the class. He was loved by folks there. And so this class of nine children one year had a Sunday school class on Easter, like a day like, you know, today. And what they did is their teacher had a really creative idea. She took every one of the children, got one of these eggs, a plastic egg, and it was empty. And they were told for 10 minutes to go outside because it was rural. There was a field and some woods that were there. And the teacher said, to really get at the idea of Easter, in America, in our culture, we get to celebrate Easter in springtime. And springtime's a great time to know what Easter's about because nature's blooming and these plants that seemed like they didn't have life a couple of months ago, they're starting to have new life to them. And so spring and Easter together, she said, I want you to all go outside and you have 10 minutes, find a symbol of new life in nature or about Easter, and then I want you to put it into the egg, and after 10 minutes you can bring it back and we'll all open our eggs together and see what sign of new life we come up with. So the kids went running out. And after a couple of minutes, the teacher went outside to monitor, and she said she could see the children. They were in the field, and they were in the woods, and all of a sudden she looked over, and Philip was swinging on a swing set. And she went over to him, and she said, Philip, you need to, you know, go get a sign of Easter for your egg. And he said, my egg's done. She said, okay. So the other kids took much longer. She called him back. They all go into the room, and she said, okay, we're going to one by one open our eggs, and what we have is a sign of Easter and spring. She goes to the first child, and he opened his egg. And there was a flower that was just starting to bloom that was there that he had picked and put into the egg. And he said, you know, this plant 2 months ago, it didn't look like it had any flowers or any life. And now it has a new flower, a new life that's coming. She said, that's exactly right. It's a great sign of Easter and spring. Thank you. She went to the next little girl and she opened hers. And there was a butterfly that was in there that was no longer able to fly because it had been captured and put into a plastic egg. And so she said, let's let that outside and see if it can recover. But you're right, a butterfly a couple of months ago wasn't a butterfly. This is not Good Friday, though. This is Easter, so we're going to let it go, and it'll be healthy, and it'll be happy, and that's great. And now let's move on to Philip. And she said, okay, Philip, what do you have in your egg? And he opened his up, and she looked, and there was nothing there. And she said, Philip, whatever you put in there has escaped. And what did you have in your egg? And he said, nothing. And she said, well, you were supposed to put something in your egg that symbolized Easter and spring. And she said, my egg is empty because the tomb was empty. The tomb was empty. And so there's nothing in my egg, and this is my sign of Easter. The teacher said, that is exactly right. And they moved on, and the other children opened their eggs. And eight children had something in their eggs, but Philip's was empty because the tomb was empty. A few months after Easter, Philip developed an infection in his young body that he wasn't able to fight off. And in a very sudden period of time, he got ill and wound up passing away. And his family and the church and the community were devastated by the loss of this little boy. The pastor knew that and wasn't surprised when the day of the memorial service came along and there were people in every pew packed. There were people standing in the back that couldn't find a place wanting to be with this family to mourn and to give thanks for his life. He said that it was particularly hard and the tragedy of it because the family had a small casket that was closed, that was put in the front of the church that everyone could see, and the loss was tangible and real. He said as the family walked in for the beginning that there was a lot of emotion that was there in the room, and the pastor gave a greeting and then invited the people to stand for the first hymn. The congregation began to sing in this memorial service. And as the song had begun, the pastor noticed a commotion in the back of the sanctuary. A door opened. And in through that door walked the Sunday school teacher and the eight remaining children in the Sunday school class. As the congregation looked and continued to sing, they walked single file down the middle aisle to the front of the sanctuary where Philip's casket lay. And they lined up in front, and then each of them pulled out a plastic egg and placed it on top of Philip's casket. They had each decorated the egg in their own artwork, but on each egg, the same words had been written by each child. The tomb was empty.
And the service proceeded with a casket of a little boy and 8 empty plastic Easter eggs. That is Easter. That's why we don't have to be afraid. Because everything in this world has been encountered by Jesus and overturned and overcome, including death. And so we mourn, but we don't mourn as people who don't have hope. Friends, what do you believe this day? You can believe in good stories that make us feel good, or you can see that something has happened in Easter that is real and has changed our world forever, beginning with a command that echoes down to us through the ages, no matter who you are, no matter what is happening in your life, no matter what you see in this world, no matter what takes place in the world to come. Jesus goes before us, he is with us, and we don't need to be afraid anymore. Hallelujah and amen. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that this day you would fill us with a hope that comes from the resurrection and liberate us and through us this world from the reality of fear. May this liberation light us up today and carry us forward in hope from this place. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Be seated. The preaching is done. We get to pray. Will you pray with me? Our God, you have delivered to us in this space astonishing news. And the thing that's hard for us to get our head around about you is that you know everything that is going on in every one of us, not in an eerie way, but in a compassionate way. So you know that some of us were up at the crack of dawn, ready to Easter, and others of us are easy like Sunday morning. And there's everything between. You know that some of us are worried about making our brunch time, and others of us are meditating in our inner soul and everything between. You reached some of us through song, and others of us through scripture, and others of us through preached word. But in all those ways that you know us and deliver to us, you gave us a gift. And an unopened gift is tragic. Here we sit knowing that Christ is alive, that the grave is conquered. We know that we don't have to be afraid anymore. But an unopened gift is tragic. So we ask you, in this room, in all the rooms in which people are hearing and gathering, that you would take it to the streets through us, that you would in our lives take this good gift out for a spin. In the next thing that happens to us, in the next conversation we have, light up a new reality in us because Jesus is alive. Freedom unclaimed, a gift unopened. It's not the way things are supposed to go. So God, please, do a thing in us because of the thing you did 2,000 years ago. Do a new thing in us, we pray, in Jesus. Amen. Friends, God has things going on in the world to which you and I can contribute. We're going to take our offering now as a part of how we respond to the good God's doing in and through us. Let's take the morning offering.
Thank you.
pray with me once again. Our God, since earliest Christian times, you have brought us together through our giving, and you have moved yourself into the world through our giving. And we just ask you to do that again. We thank you for generous hearts and the way you've planted them in us. We thank you for all the good you involve us through together. And we pray that and thank you for it in Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
As a reminder, we invite you to take your bulletins home with you to see what's coming up in the life of this community and to see if there might be a way that you can join us in the journey ahead as God continues to do a good thing among us. 2,000 years ago, something changed the world forever, and we are a part of that story. And today, as you go forward, no matter what this world might throw at you, what it might throw at us, as hard as it may be, the tomb is empty. And we don't need to be afraid anymore. So go forward
And in your going, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, and may it keep you and all whom you love. And God's people said together, Amen. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.